What's good, you guys? Welcome to the most gorgeous episode of the Ranveer Show with the most gorgeous guest that we've had on the show, Priyanka Chopra. What can be said about this beautiful woman and this beautiful mind that's not already been said? So in the time that I had with her through this podcast, we really were trying to dig deep to find out what keeps her clock ticking, what keeps her mentality and ambition going. We even spoke about her mental health issues, her experiences in the early part of her career, how she built herself up to this point, and even her plans for the future. Trust me, one of the most inspiring conversations I've ever had on a personal level, because she's someone who's inspired me a lot, but I've also had the biggest crush on her growing up. So without further ado, I hope you enjoy one of the most memorable moments of my life. Enjoy yourselves. So there's queens that you come across in your life, and then there's like mega, hyper, super queens. And that's what we've got today. Priyanka Chopra, welcome to the Ranveer Show.
Oh, thank you so much for having me.
So before asking you any questions, could I just tell you two thoughts of you that I've got in my head?
Of course, please.
Okay, so the first is that, you know, with Bollywood celebrities, usually the nation always has mixed opinions on them. Like you have some people who like you and some people who don't like you. But with Priyanka Chopra, irrespective of age, gender, caste, all that, everyone loves you. Like
That's, first of all, very, very kind. And second of all, I don't think that's true.
That's true. That's we'll get to the haters later.
Haters don't exist in my life.
Exactly. I feel that vibe. But really, you're someone who generally is super magnetic, and that's why the nation has backed you. The second thing I really want to tell you is that the first time I ever realized that a guy can like a girl, and I realized that this concept of crushes exists, you were my first crush in life after I saw Andaz. So
after Andaz?
Yeah.
Oh my. So you really must like me.
No, you were fantastic. You stole the show. I remember you coming on the second half. I remember that movie like as the back of my hand.
Yeah, I did. I came in after the interval.
Yeah.
So, and my story was done before the climax.
Yeah. No, but you stole the show.
Thank you.
So the first question I have for you is, what is the secret to this magnetism? Because it's not inbuilt. It's something you've worked on over time.
I wasn't born with it, I would say. I think it's called confidence.
Okay.
I feel like confidence is something you can teach yourself. Confidence is, and you know, your story is a little bit like that. You taught yourself and you told yourself what you wanted to be, and you worked towards it.
You're one of the people I learned it from.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. But that's what I mean. I learned it from my mother. I learned it from the very, very strong people in my family that I looked up to, that showed me that it doesn't matter what your circumstances are, it matters how large your dreams are. And I have really large dreams.
And you know what I love about you? Even now, I'm pretty sure you're as ambitious as you were when you started out.
Yeah.
Everyone can see that.
My ambition gives me purpose. Yeah. And I think purpose is very important in life. You have to have a sense of purpose. Whatever that might be, it could be your children, it could be your family, it could be your career, it could be anything. But as a human being, I feel like my purpose is the I think my purpose is the pursuit of excellence in anything that I do. I don't like doing anything less than perfect.
When you're dying, what do you want people to remember you as?
I want them to say that I left behind a legacy. I want my kids to feel like, you know, proud to say that that's our mom. I want people to say that I made a dent in my art, in entertainment, in my profession, that I'm a public person, that actually through every facet of my life, whether it was my acting, my producing, my philanthropy, just being a girl.
Can I tell you something?
Yeah, of course.
So right now, Indians, when they're looking at Priyanka Chopra, every single Indian's like, that's our girl, that's our girl. That's what you've been able to do like right now.
So see, that's already amazing. I mean, eventually, it makes me, I'm from a very small town. I was raised in Bareilly. I was born in Jamshedpur. My dad's from Punjab. I think that if I can have aspirations and be sitting on this chair being interviewed by you, hearing the words that you're saying, it can happen to anyone as long as you have the perseverance to go there.
Yeah. So my next question to you is, when you began in Bollywood, I'm sure you had like a version of it, you know, before you started out.
For sure.
And then it must have changed something in you. So what were those things that you saw and you were like, wait, okay, so this world works like this?
Well, when I first came, I was 17 when I won Miss India and Miss World. I just turned 18. I started getting movie offers. So at that time, it was very like, oh yeah, being an actor is about wearing the nicest clothes and like getting hair and makeup done and like, you know, saying your lines and like dancing. And it was very trivial in my head because no one from my entire family had ever even been to Bombay. Forget. Yeah. like been in entertainment. My dad was a musician, but that was his joy, and he used to sing on stage. It was never in the business of entertainment. But when I started working, like in Andaz, for example, there was a moment where, you know that song, the one in with Akshay and me when we're in South Africa. Yeah, what is the song called?
Yeah. When you're partying.
No. The other one. The romantic song. That one. So that was one of the first songs we shot. And so there were multiple things that I had to achieve at that point. But, and once the 40-something take had happened and I didn't get it right, I remember Raju Khan was the choreographer at that time, who's Saroji's son. He threw his mic down and he said, just because you're Miss World, you think you can become an actress? Go learn how to dance and then come back and perform. And luckily, Akshay's wife went into labor at that point, so the schedule went was cut short. And we came back to India just for a break. And I remember going to Pandit Viru Krishan's class and started learning Kathak. I did about 6 hours every single day.
Wow.
And then when I went back for the next schedule, I knew so much more. And that day I realized that there's something about knowledge. There's something about if you learn, even if you don't know something, if you have an ambition to be somewhere, if you prepare yourself, you have the ability to be better than everyone else.
So you decided to level up at every stage.
I like to be prepared for everything. Even if it's an interview, even if I'm going for a red carpet, even if something is trivial to someone.
Even if you're stepping up and becoming a Bollywood producer.
No? Yes, I like to learn, which is why as becoming a Hindi movie producer, the reason I decided to do produce Sky is Pink was because the producers are Sid Roy Kapoor and Ronnie Screwvala. As producers, I admire them tremendously. I've done about 6 films with them, Barfi, Fashion, films that have defined my career. So I knew I could learn again from them. So I'm new as a producer, so I'm working with people who I can learn from.
Are you nervous about this release?
It's too special for me to be nervous. Whatever the destiny of this film is, I know it doesn't have the comedy and laughter and the big set number and the song pieces. I know it's not that film. But at the same time, there's something that has come really from the deep pinnacles of my heart, because it's based on a real life couple, not some, you know, medal winning athlete like I played the last time, or not some superstar. It's based on real people with extraordinary circumstances, and that's something very special.
Yeah. You know, the film portrays like the real kind of trajectory of a relationship. So what have you learned from your relationships in your life? And I'm not just talking about romantic relationships, mm-hmm. all kinds. What's that added to you?
I think honesty is very important in relationships, whether it's with friends, whether it's with family, whether it's with your loved one, whether it's in a romantic relationship. I think being real to what you really are feeling is very important. And a lot of people don't have the guts to do that, because we are always pretending to be a certain way so that we can maintain a relationship. But I think the healthiest relationships happen when you have the ability to call out someone and say, well, that's not right, or I don't feel a certain way and you're wrong or you're right, and to be able to talk about it. It takes taking that cloak of being careful about your emotions off. That's very important.
You know, so I've seen a lot of your interviews in my life, and I can see how inspired you are from your parents.
Yeah.
And I'm sure you're inspired from their relationship as well.
Totally.
What have you learned from them?
I think the beauty about their relationship was it was a relationship of equals from the very beginning. You know, my parents, even though they had separate responsibilities and they always worked together, but they always gave each other respect in terms of each other's opinions. And I was raised in an environment like that. My mom's opinion was as important as my dad's opinion. They both took decisions together. It was never one person's monopoly. And that's an extremely healthy marriage.
So Priyanka, they were both physicians in the army. And I'm sure that that job comes with a lot of discipline.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sure that discipline trickled down at home as well.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a part of your growing up. And would you say that discipline is also the reason that you've become Priyanka Chopra, like the Priyanka Chopra? Has discipline been a big part of your life?
Yes. I think people confuse discipline with like punctuality sometimes, but that's not what discipline is. Discipline is being prepared. Discipline is riyaz. Discipline is training. Discipline is learning. Discipline is knowing that if I'm going to do a job, I'm going to give it my 120%. Otherwise, I'm not going to do it. Because when it comes to the military, even one mistake can cause a big, big butterfly effect. And that's something I definitely learned from both my parents as physicians and as people who were in the military.
And, you know, again, from a lot of times when you're in the middle of your hustle, you don't come to know how good you are And you need an outside perspective.
Right.
So trust me, from the outside, again, seeing your career, you're someone who's constantly moved on to the next project, even after victories. Is that something you do consciously, that if a film is a hit, you're like, cool, good, I'll be zen about it, but I'll move on to the next one?
Yeah, I mean, I really feel like you are defined by, every time, you're defined by what you do next, not what you left behind.
So when you have a super hit film, what's going on in your head?
Great, that happened. What's next?
I like that.
How am I going to top that? Yeah. Or what am I going to do that's going to be different? It might not be the same thing, because there's no point of doing the same thing over again. I try not to do the same thing over again. You have to take risks. Risks are so important in evolution. Playing it safe. Yeah, you can have an existence, but you'll never be someone who's a trailblazer.
Who's a legend.
Yeah. And legendary shit. I like legendary shit.
We can see that. What did you learn from your dad that stayed with you for your career and that's been an anchor point for your career?
To smile through everything. My dad was extremely sensitive, but he was also like my biggest champion. The one thing that I learned from him was the hustle. He always taught me that don't be afraid of the failure. What you do next after failure is what will define you. Everyone fails. It's going to happen to you. It's going to happen to me. It's going to happen to everyone. Instead of sitting on your hands and saying, I can't do it again, find the courage inside of you and saying, what can I do differently? How do you look back into your mistake and say, all right, that was a mistake. Great. Not doing that again. That's something I really learned from my dad.
Yeah. And that whole thing about you being magnetic, this is a part of it, that you smile through everything. So the other thing I really want to know from you is, you know, in like people with generally with the Indian youth, there's these huge mental health issues that are going around because of social media and things like that. So through your career, have you had any mental health issues which you've just hidden by, like, you know, smiling through it?
I think so. I think each one of us has. I don't know if I, because I never went to a therapist. I kind of therapized myself.
Because you didn't need one.
No, I tried it. I tried it a couple of times. There were phases in my life, especially after my dad. I didn't know how to deal with my emotions. I was in a new country. I didn't know people. I was walking into meetings where people didn't know me. I was reintroducing myself at the age of 31, 32 after I had conquered another industry in India. So, you know, all of those things added a lot of pressures on me, you know, when you're starting all over again in another country where a culture is different, everything was different and I was alone. So it took a big toll on me at that point. And I don't know if I can clinically say I was depressed or not, but I really felt like I was. I tried to go to therapist, but because I didn't have the consistency of time, I didn't follow through. So I kind of logified with myself. I'm someone who talks to myself and I think about things, whether it's in my dreams or whether it's when I'm awake. I talk to myself about how I'm feeling and how I can overcome it.
What did you tell yourself that got you out of your difficult times?
I told myself to allow myself to feel it.
To accept it.
To accept it. I think you have to reach a place of acceptance of the fact that it's okay to feel that way instead of beating yourself up about it.
Did you also keep your mind busy with work?
For a while, I did. And that was not the best decision. It was me running away from my issues, whereas I realized that especially when you have something that you're mentally feeling like you can't move on from, you have to find support. You have to find someone you can rely on. I relied a lot on my friends at that point. I relied a lot on, I chose instead of being alone and dealing with it alone, I would go out, seek out people that actually care about me. And I think a lot of kids don't do that. We, because of stuff we read and people's opinions that we read online. And trust me, no one has more opinions about people, I mean, about someone as they do about me. I get so many opinions from people, good, bad, ugly. And I could very easily succumb under the pressure of it. But I feel like social media can be good and can be evil. If you focus on the good, the idea of social media was to get people together. It was never to make people feel like they are...
Targeted.
They are targets. Exactly. So I think instead of focusing on the negativity and taking the pressure off, it's important if you're feeling down, dark, deep, to not keep it to yourself, to not be alone. It's very important to find someone that you can talk to, even if they can't help you. It doesn't have to be a therapist. It could be your mom. It could be your friend. It could be someone. But don't do it alone.
God, that's your biggest advice.
Yes.
Find support from
someone. Find support. Because a lot of kids end up like taking their lives, end up, you know, getting into deep, dark places because they think they have to solve it themselves. You don't have to.
Also, you know, The Sky is Pink as a movie, from the trailer, you can tell that there's this whole concept of the mother helping her daughter. And I'm sure that the main characters have their own mental health issues through the film. So what have you picked up from this film, being a part of it?
I think the beauty of this film was the takeaway of this movie, which I think when you guys go and watch it, you'll realize that it's the philosophy of the movie. What she means by a sky is pink is, don't let anyone tell you what the color of your sky should be. When Aditi was, which is the character I play, was her daughter was diagnosed with a terminal illness. She was in London getting her daughter treated alone while her husband was taking care of her son, who was 4 years old in Delhi. And one day her son called her up while she was in London and was crying and stammering and said that, you know, mom, the teacher really yelled at me because when in painting class, she made me stand in the corner because in painting class I made the sky pink. And she said, the sky is blue. But the sky can be, is the sky blue? So the mother got so affected by that. And she said, don't ever let anyone define to you what your sky should be. So it's a metaphor of live your life on your terms. Don't let anyone's expectations of you define what you want to do. It's not their life, it's yours. Yeah. So I found that so beautiful about the movie, that it's about, it doesn't matter if your life is long or not. It matters if it's big. 100%. And this movie is about that.
So, you know, Priyanka Chopra is inspiring, but Priyanka Chopra's mom is equally inspiring.
Yeah.
How much of your mom have you put into this movie?
A lot of it. My mom was very ferociously protective about me. It was very important to her that every dream that I had, whether it was small, whether it was big, my aspirations were fulfilled. My parents never wanted me to have a what if in my life. What if I had done it? What if I had tried that? So they always supported me. They said, no matter what you do, whatever mistake you make, have the confidence to come and tell us. Because, like, even if you kill someone, my dad, I remember him telling me this, even if you kill someone, come and tell me, I'll help you find the body. I'll help you bury the body, but then I'll take you to the cops too. So you'll always have to have courage of conviction, which was something my parents have taught me.
And they're big support systems in your life.
Very much.
Even till today.
Yes,
so, you know,
much.
From the outside, again, it seems like everything is perfect for you. Are there any challenges in your life right now, or do you keep challenging yourself through your work?
I just feel like because I'm a public person, it's very easy for my entire life to be an open book. But I like to keep a few things to myself. I feel like I want to be like a duck, you know, paddling furiously under the water.
But low-key.
But looking really low-key and calm outside. And I feel like grace under fire is what I believe I want to be. Having dignity and grace is really important to me. Everyone has struggles. I don't like to be a victim. I'll find my own solutions. They might be good for me, bad for me, but they'll be mine.
What message do you have for a young girl watching this or listening to this podcast?
Well, the one thing I would definitely say is there's no do or die in this world. Nothing is important enough for you to take so much pressure that it defines your life. You have to be like water.
Yeah.
You know, learn to be like water.
Adaptable,
fit into any vessel, have a sense of calm, have a sense of patience. But ambition is extremely important. And I don't just say this to girls. I say this to boys and girls. Just everyone who wants to be able to have a purpose in life, have an ambition. Have the guts to find your glory. It's extremely important to have guts, to have conviction, to be able to say that, you know, this is what I want and I want to achieve it.
And to challenge yourself?
Yes, I find challenging myself extremely fulfilling. I do my best work when I feel nervous. I do my best work under pressure. But that doesn't work for everyone. Some people like to work in a sense of calm. I like to work in a sense of chaos.
Beautiful. Okay, Priyanka Chopra, you inspire me every day. You inspire the whole country every day. And I'm dead sure 10 years from now, you're going to be running one of the biggest production houses that this country's seen. Because I feel like every stage, people have always challenged you and they've doubted you about like the things you've done, and you've always proved people wrong. When you're dying, you're going to be remembered as a legend of the world and not just this country.
You're very, very kind. Thank you. Tumhare muh mein ghee shak hai, jaise kehte hain.
So thank you for being on the Ranveer Show.
Thank you so much for having me.
And if you could ask everyone to subscribe, that would be...
Hey guys, you're watching the Ranveer Show. You must subscribe to this podcast.
Thank you, Priyanka.
Thank you. Thank you.